synagogue. And you see, later we'll see the ruins of the synagogue over there. Actually, there are ruins of two different synagogues. One is from the time of Jesus, but most of it is underground. And the one that was renovated, it's 4th, 5th century. So at the same location, we have ruins of two different synagogues. The last one was destroyed by an earthquake. The whole city was destroyed by a massive earthquake, we think in 749 AD. 749 AD, big earthquake, everything was lost. But the synagogue was the place, you know, the word for synagogue in Hebrew? Beit Knesset, Beit House, Knesset Assembly. So it means House of Assembly. The way you have to think about synagogues at the time of Jesus, it was not a temple, it was not, because it will be a mistake to call it a temple. A temple, there was only one, the one in Jerusalem. That's why it was required by the pilgrims to go there 3 times a year. Every Passover, Pentecost, Tabernacle, was the only place where Jewish people came to offer sacrifices in Jerusalem. You couldn't do it in a synagogue. So the synagogue was a place to pray, a place to worship, but also a place for other activities. Maybe we'll have to think about it as a community center for all community activities, a place to meet each other, to discuss things. That's the way it all changed after the destruction of the last temple in Jerusalem. The last temple was destroyed by the Romans in 70, and then later the synagogues became a substitute to the temple, but with one major difference, no more sacrifices. See, the moment that the temple was only in Jerusalem, it was possible to... So the synagogue here was a kind of a community center, a place to teach, to study, to meet one another. And you all know that Jesus, when he came to Capernaum, it became the center of his teaching. And many of the miracles recorded in the Bible took place where? In Capernaum. The story about the paralytic who was lowered through the roof. Capernaum. Peter's mother-in-law. The son of the centurion. The woman who had an issue of blood, who came and touched his tassel. It was also in everything Capernaum. Jairus' daughter, the head of the synagogue. All took place in Capernaum. Because Jesus, he went all over Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, that's what the Bible says all everywhere, but always returned back to Capernaum. The church that you see here, it was built 20 years ago, named after Peter, St. Peter's Church. And underneath, later you will walk to the railing, you see all the way to the railing, you can also visit the church. And inside the church, inside there is a glass floor where you can look through the floor and see the ruins underneath. Or you can also see it from the railing. It's actually ruins of an old church. It's built on the house of Peter. Peter himself, he came from Bethsaida, which is another village 5 kilometers away. But when he was in Capernaum, he would have stayed here probably with his mother-in-law in the house here, the place where also Jesus had healed Peter's mother-in-law, the fever, he touched her hand and the fever left her. Now we are all have the confidence that this was the house of Peter or the mother-in-law because of several reasons. On the walls of the house, they discovered the stock of plaster. Several layers of plaster with the name, and also on the plaster the name of Peter. So it was like an old graffiti that somebody wrote. But also, look at the location, it's near, not far away from the synagogue. Now, in Mark chapter 1, the Gospel of Mark, we read about this amazing miracle that Jesus performed in the synagogue. He healed this man with the unclean spirit. Remember that story? And then later it says, as soon as they came out of the synagogue, they've entered the house of Peter and Andrew. So you see, it's like it's an indication it was close, nearby. As soon as they came out, they went into the house of Peter and Andrew with James and John. So very close, it fits. Now, if we ask ourselves why from all the different towns and villages did Jesus choose here, Capernaum, to become the center of his teaching and ministry? Because it is very central, and it's also a fulfillment of a biblical prophecy. The prophecy of Isaiah 9. It says, in the former time, he brought into condemn the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the later time, he will make glorious the way of the sea, the land behind Jordan, Galilee of the nations. So think about that. Capernaum was located nearby this ancient road,
the Bi'Amaris. Remember, the Bi'Amaris left Egypt along the coast of Israel, down to the Jordan Valley, Tiberias, Magdala, Capernaum, and then north to Damascus. Damascus in Syria. Okay? So that was the main road connecting the continents, Asia, Europe, and Africa. And because if you think about that, this is very, very powerful talk. 65% of the gospel is right here. Capernaum, from, let's say from Magdala and Nazareth to the other side of the lake, the Decapolis area. So in the distance of like 15 kilometers, or maybe a little bit more, you have 65% of the gospel. So it's not a very large area, right? But the impact was much more than that. Because people who have traveled along the road, they've told about all the great things Jesus has done. So it says, because what it says in the Bible, that his fame spread out all over Syria. Not only here. Syria, people have heard about him far away from him. It says that his fame went out through the Decapolis, Jerusalem, Judea, behind the Jordan. So from this very central place here, people have heard about this all over. Again, because think about Israel being the land bridge, connecting the continents back then. It said this was an ancient place.
The center.
Exactly, the center. Think about Israel and the God's land. God chose the land, the center of the whole universe. The continent. So this is very powerful. There was a reason why I came there. The center. Okay, what I would like to show you, I would like to take you just around and to show you an ancient olive press.